I'd like to talk to you now about computing Fourier series. Now, just because it's a computation doesn't mean it's routine or boring. In fact, the ideas behind computing Fourier series are the start for much deeper ideas in math, and I think they are pretty interesting in their own right, and I hope by the end of the video you'll agree with me. When we get to the key idea of this computation, we're going to need the values of some integrals. So let's discuss those in order to prepare for that. Now these integrals will involve some integers, so let's let k and l be positive integers. Now let's consider the following products of cosines and sines. We're going to consider cosine of kx times sine of lx, cosine of kx times cosine of lx, and sine of kx times sine of lx. Now the integrals that we're interested in are integrals of these products over intervals of length 2 pi. Now I'm going to choose the interval of length 2 pi to be the interval minus pi to pi, and we will discuss some other intervals shortly. Now I realize I'm using the words integral, interval, and integer, and I apologize for that. Can't help it. I'm going to go ahead and give you the values of these integrals, and I think you might even be surprised as to how simple they turn out. The first one, no matter what k and l are, as long as they're positive integers, I'll always get 0. The second one, it depends on k and l, so I break it into two cases. The case in which k is not equal to l, I get 0. The case in which k equals l, I get pi. Same goes for the third integral. I get 0 if k is not equal to l, and pi if k equals l. As always, I encourage you not to take my word for it, but to do these computations yourself. So I'll give you that as an exercise. Check these computations. To keep things interesting, I'll give you a couple things to think about while you do this exercise. One is this hypothesis on k and l necessary? So what about k and l less than or equal to 0? Can I still say that the same formulas hold? Another thing to think about would be other intervals besides minus pi to pi. So what about integrals over other intervals, a to b? Can I replace minus pi to pi with some other a to b and get the same formulas? I encourage you to pause the video and to do this exercise right now. If you get stuck, you can come back because I'm going to give you a hint right now. So, hint. I'll give you a hint for evaluating this integral with the cosines. Use a trig identity. And the trig identity that comes in handy is the product to sum identity for cosine. The product cosine theta times cosine phi is equal to 1/2 times cosine theta plus phi plus cosine theta minus phi. We're ready now to move on to the big idea behind Fourier series. So take one last note of these formulas here because we're going to need them. Okay, we're ready for the big idea. Let's suppose that we know what f of x is and we want to find these Fourier coefficients ak, bk. So suppose that we have the Fourier expansion of f. Suppose that f of x is equal to this sum of sines and cosines. And this equality doesn't have to be everywhere. Remember when we did the Fourier expansion, we found that it was only equal on the interval minus pi to pi. So let's suppose that this is at least on the interval minus pi to pi. That'll be good enough for our purposes. One more thing to note here is that I put a0 over 2 instead of a0, and that's just a very minor thing. It's just a matter of convenience, and you'll see why I did it in a moment. Now here's the trick. Let's take both sides of this expression. Let's multiply both sides by the cosine of lx, where l is a positive integer. So you see why I left those little spaces when I wrote it down. I had a plan. And I'm going to integrate from minus pi to pi. All of these terms. I'll pull the constants out just by default rather than leaving them inside the integrals. I'm going to leave the dx's off the ends of these integrals just because I don't want to write them. Now, I should point out one little thing which is inconsistent with our notation from the last slide. On the last slide, we let k and l be positive integers, and I want to allow l equals 0 in this situation. So let's make a note. L equals 0 is allowed. Okay, what have we got? Well, on the right-hand side, we have three types of integrals, all of which we can evaluate. So let's look at them one by one. This one first. This is an integral from minus pi to pi of sine kx times cosine lx. Well, if k and l are positive integers, we know from the last slide that this integral is 0. The only case not covered is when l is equal to 0, in which case this is the integral of just sine kx, which is also 0. So this integral is always 0. What about this one? Well, this looks just like an integral from the last slide. If k and l are positive integers, then this will be either 0 or pi, according to whether k is not equal to l or k equals l. So it's 0 for k not equal to l, and it's pi for k equals l. And the only situation not covered by the last slide is when l is 0, and in that case we have just the integral of cosine kx, which is 0. So we can have that kind of covered by this situation, k is not equal to l. Finally, we have this guy. Now this guy is going to be 0 except in the situation when l is 0. So only in the case that l is 0, this guy will be actually 2 pi. And now maybe you see why I have this 2. I want that 2 to cancel with this 2. You may have figured out what it is that we're up to at this point. We're multiplying by cosine lx, and we're integrating from minus pi to pi, and what that's doing is essentially picking off the al coefficient. So for instance, if l is 0, then we get this guy is the only term which is non-zero, and it's equal to pi times a0. If l is 1, then just the first term here is the only one that's non-zero, and it's pi times a1. If l is 2, we get pi times a2, etc. So no matter what l is, l equals 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, etc., this guy is equal to pi times al. Now I'd like to do a similar thing to find the bl coefficients. So what I'll do is I'll just take that same sum that I had before, and instead of multiplying by cosine lx, I will multiply by sine lx and integrate again from minus pi to pi. Now you can see it's a very similar situation, slightly different, in that now the terms for a0 and ak will drop out, and I will be left with just the bk terms. And you can verify the details, but it's not hard to see that you will get pi times bl as a result. I should say, just to be clear, that there is no b0 term. So this formula that we have here is only valid for l equals 1, 2, 3, etc. In fact, if we let l equal 0 in this equality, we just get 0 equals 0, so it doesn't tell us anything. Now let me summarize what it is that we've done here. We started out with f of x being a sum of sines and cosines. So we know f, and we want to figure out what those coefficients are in that sum of sines and cosines. We want to figure out the a's and the b's. And so by this very clever trick, we are able to compute the a's and the b's by integrating the product of f and cosine, or f and sine, and then of course dividing by pi. So it gives us a way to figure out the a's and the b's purely by computing a certain integral involving f. I have summarized all of our computations in an official formula that we can use. So it says that if you want to compute the Fourier expansion of f of x, then the coefficients in the expansion, ak and bk, are given by the following formulas. 1 over pi times this integral of f times cosine, and 1 over pi times this integral of f times sine. Now, I've replaced the equality with the twiddle again, and what I want you to think is, I want you to think of this twiddle as meaning simply equal on an interval. So remember, we had assumed that we had equality on minus pi to pi, and that was how we deduced these formulas. Now, I really should point out that it's not completely correct to say that if I compute the Fourier series in this manner using these formulas, then the result will be equal to f on the interval minus pi to pi. That's not always true. But for our current purposes, we might as well just assume that that's the case. And we'll discuss more about this later when we talk about convergence of Fourier series. It's definitely now time for an example. So let's look back at that Fourier series that we did in the first video that I just simply gave to you. And that was the Fourier series for f of x equals x. Let's compute each of the ak's and the bk's via these formulas. So I know that ak is going to be given by 1 over pi times the integral from minus pi to pi of x times cosine kx, and bk similarly will be 1 over pi integral from minus pi to pi of x times sine of kx. I claim that the ak's are actually easy to compute. They're all zero. Now, the way we see this is by noticing that x is an odd function and cosine kx is an even function for any of our k's. So the product is an odd function. We're integrating an odd function over an interval which is symmetric about zero, and the result will always be zero. Now, the bk's, we need to actually do a computation, and that computation is a simple integration by parts. And I've done it ahead of time, so I'll tell you what the answer is. 2 times minus 1 to the k plus 1 divided by k. And I encourage you to check this using integration by parts. So it's a good exercise. And that's it, we're done. So we have that the Fourier expansion for x is given by this sum. All of the ak's are 0, including a0. And so we just have the bk's times sine kx. The bk's are given by these formulas. So we have 2 times the sum from k equals 1 to infinity of minus 1 to the k plus 1 divided by k times the sine of kx. Now, if you compare that to the expression that we had in the last video, you'll find it's exactly the same. Now I've got something for you to try. So here's an exercise, and it's a pretty interesting exercise and not too hard. What I want you to do is compute the Fourier series for x again, but do it on a different interval, not the interval minus pi to pi. Do it on the interval 0 to 2 pi. So compute Fourier series for x on 0 to 2 pi. Now, the mechanics of doing this are pretty simple. These formulas can be used. All you have to do is modify them so that they're valid not on minus pi to pi, but on the interval 0 to 2 pi. So you just replace the bounds of integration with the appropriate ones. You should go back and check and make sure that the computation that we did on the last slide still goes through. Nothing funny happens. And in fact, you should notice that I can do the computation with any interval of length 2 pi. It doesn't have to be minus pi to pi or 0 to 2 pi. It can be any interval of length 2 pi. Now, just so you can check your computations, I'll tell you what I got, and I'll call it the answer. I'm just that confident. I got A0, and well, let's call it A0 over 2. A0 over 2, I got to be pi. All the other AKs are 0. And I got BK to be minus 2 over K. And that's for, of course, k greater than or equal to 1. I encourage you to graph this solution using Mathematica, MATLAB, whatever, and take a look and see that it actually converges to the function x on the interval 0 to 2 pi rather than the interval minus pi to pi as this expression does. We'll conclude with one final example, and I've written it out ahead of time so you don't have to watch me scribble. The example is f of x equals absolute value x, and we'll compute the Fourier series on the interval minus pi to pi. So we use the usual formulas for finding the coefficients. Ak is this integral of absolute value x times cosine kx. Now this integral can be split into two pieces, one piece where x is negative and the other piece where x is positive. And you can evaluate each of those pieces using integration by parts. It's not hard then to arrive at this formula for the coefficient ak. On the other hand, a0 I'll do separately. So cosine kx is just 1, and so I get just the integral of absolute value x, and that's pi. The bk's will all be 0, and the reason for that is similar to the reason that we learned before, which is I have an even function times an odd function, and it's a symmetric interval, so I always get an integral of 0. Put it all together, and we get the following Fourier series for absolute value x. Don't forget to divide that a0 term by 2. And I've made an animation just to show you the successive terms of the Fourier series and their approximation to absolute value x. The V shape here, of course, is the absolute value function. And this is the first term of the Fourier series, just pi over 2. So I'll begin adding terms. It gets pretty close, pretty quick. So there's just 6 terms, and I can't really see much difference between the two functions. So it's a nice Fourier series for a maybe not so nice function, absolute value x.